So the user becomes the sort of end, the final stage in the product design, which means that they sort of determine what is it? Is it a stool, is it a stepladder, is it a storage device? So, you know, when you kind of look at it as a white object, or object on a white background, it has that like ambiguity, which I thought was important. It's manufactured by a company in Italy called Danese that goes back to the 1950s and made a lot of really great work with like Enzo Mari and Bruno Minari in the 60s and 70s. So this is actually an educational space that I worked on for the Nouveau Musée National in Monaco. I like the silhouette. the space sort of starts from the idea of the detail and connecting and the connections that happen within the space. So it's an educational space which had to serve a variety of functions. One is the museum hosts a municipal garden where they do workshops with local students, like high school students. So the space is in the museum, it's an art museum, and it had to somehow deal with the garden. It also had to deal with the exhibitions on display in the show, or rather on show in the museum. So we host a collection of books that relate to whatever artist is on view in the museum. It also has to host workshops for local students, so we have workshop tools on the right. And the idea of the framework that's mounted to the walls, it's really, I mean, in a way it's almost like it doesn't have an explicit purpose other than hosting these different types of content. So we made the analogy to something like a website or like a blog where you have like a graphic format to which the curators of the museum can plug content. So they're plugging in, you know, it's also a trilingual museum, they speak French, English, and Italian, and Italian, so they can update the text about whatever's on view in the room. I also worked on the tables for this space. And then like, here we have like a bulletin board and like any good blog, there's an about section that tells you a little bit what the room was. This is the second furniture project I worked on and was the longest furniture project. It took 4 years from beginning to end. But basically I started working with the furniture manufacturer Knoll, which is based in New York City. And we said, why wouldn't we, let's look at the typology of like outdoor chairs and outdoor seating. And let's look at how they're made. And let's look at how we can make them a bit better, per se, or a bit more practical, or a little bit more functional. So at the time, this is like now maybe 8 years ago, there were a lot of plastic chairs going outdoors, and there were a lot of metal chairs going outdoors, but they're all made with like tube, or they're made with slats. And so the plastic chairs might be really comfortable. On the other hand, the metal chairs are really rigid and not so comfortable. But a metal chair has the durability that you want for outdoors, and it has the weight that you want for outdoors, so it doesn't get knocked around and blown around in the wind. So the real breakthrough, we were working with a number of suppliers, some of them here in California, that do superforming and hydroforming of aluminum sheets. So what that means is you take a really thin sheet of aluminum, you heat it, and it starts to sort of buckle. If you've ever done vacuum forming, it's really similar. And then you press it either with water or air pressure or a secondary mold into a mold shape. So we were trying to do that with the seat shell that you see here. And in the previous image, you can see some of these shells, like these yellow ones here. These are prototype hydroforming. Problem became, how do you connect it to the frame? So we were casting a frame and we were trying to join that with a skin, and it was just the most expensive process ever to join the two pieces. So we ended up, out of frustration, sort of jokingly suggesting to the producer of the frame, could you just cast the whole thing in one piece? And normally, I mean, this is a bit technical, maybe a bit boring, but if you think about castings, aluminum castings, you usually think of them as being bone-like, not skin-like. And so that was sort of my preconceived idea of how we would work with a casting. But on the supplier of the die casting said, well, we make skins all the time. And so a couple days later, I got this massive box, a crate FedEx to the office of an engine cut in half. And the engine had this 2 millimeter wall thickness, really thin skin going all the way around. So we totally rethought the whole project and designed this shell, which is cast in one piece, so that you have a really thin section where you want like your comfort, and then the bone-like parts build out towards the legs. So it, you know, the stacking chair in the end, and we paint it in different colors. And then we also polish it sometimes. This is a nice, this is kind of a nice thing when you get to start to see products entering the real world, and they kind of leave your studio and they start showing up in places. So this is office, Kirsten Gears, David Van Severen's office in Belgium, in Brussels, and they bought a number of these chairs for the office. And then you get to see them sort of next to some of your other favorite chairs, like this is the Donut armchair, and Martin Van Severen 0.04 chair. And somehow, like, when your work starts entering the world, that's really an exciting moment. It starts butting up against all these other things. So, speaking of other things, I don't just, my practice stuff, I don't only design products, I also do a lot of exhibitions and books about design. This is an exhibition that I co-curated with Jasper Morrison and Marco Villardi. It's called Source Material. And what we did was we thought, why don't we were kind of hanging out one day, the three of us in Paris, and we were like, what should we do about this kind of idea of like, the Milan Furniture Fair happens every year, and every time you go, it's this sort of barrage of marketing materials and new chairs, and now you have like Samsung debuting new televisions, and toilet companies, and car companies, and it's just, it used to be, you know, maybe 10, 15 years ago when I started going, it was a much purer week. You could go and really see expressions of design and things that you really take home with you afterwards. So we thought, well, what's missing there? So we thought, well, rather than talk about new products, new ideas, why don't we ask people about their old ideas, their old points of reference? And so we asked about 60 different creative minds from the fields of architecture, graphic design, photography, artists, cooks and chefs, musicians, and even a couple of like production designers, filmmakers, and actors, to give us an object that at some point in the span of their career had completely changed the way that they think and work. And so we got really beautiful things. Like this one, one of my favorites. It's my technical musical terminology is really bad, but basically that's a trumpet stopper. So it's something that you put in a trumpet to stop the trumpet from making sounds. And this here is an amplifier. It's used for certain instruments to sort of amplify the sound. So this is an object of K.K. Barrett. He's the production designer who did Being John Malkovich, Her, Where the Wild Things Are, Lost in Translation. He basically does all the production design for Sofia Coppola and Spike Jonze. And he also has roots in punk. So he was in the Screamers. He was like the drummer for the punk band the Screamers in L.A. in the 70s. Anyway, somewhere along his career, he discovered this object and sort of the tension, he describes the tension that's created between something that's meant to stop sound and something that's meant to amplify sound. And in his work, he always tries to have that level of tension between two opposing forces. And so there's a lot of these stories. Each one of these objects represents something really special for a different person. And so we were able to kind of capture them in these vitrines. Maybe another one, this sewing machine belongs to Erwan Borlak, the designer, and it was his mother's sewing machine, which he eventually stole, I think, from his mother. And he, as a kid, he taught himself how to sew on this thing, and he used to fight with his brother over it. And basically, you know, if you look at the upholstery work that those two designers have done, they've done some of the most probably important work in upholstery in the last 20 years in terms of sofas and larger architectural upholstered objects. So you think like when the guy was 8 years old or 10 years old, he's like stealing the sewing machine from his mother. So, you know, kind of, this show in a way was like the new design exhibition in Milan. It was the old design exhibition. And so we showed it in Milan at Kaleidoscope Magazine's Project Space, and then it went to the Vitra Design Museum, which is the photos you just saw. The next project, the building right here on the right is the Vitra Design Museum. Building back there, kind of interesting story with Frank Gehry and all of this. Frank Gehry was hired was a friend of Klaus Oldenburg, and he was brought to the Vitra campus in the, I think, early 80s to install this Klaus Oldenburg. As a result, he developed a good friendship with Rolf Felsbaum, who is the CEO of Vitra, who then commissioned the Design Museum. The building you see in the far background is this sort of, outside of the really elaborate stairwell, it's really like an anonymous box of a building. And that building, it could be like a factory in Burbank, or like somewhere you pass, one of these like anonymous industrial buildings. So after the source material exhibition, Vitra asked myself and an architect in London named Pernilla Orsted to collaborate on the contents of the second floor of that anonymous box. You can see the sort of Gary's staircases on either side. But we were given this, it's roughly a 20,000 square foot interior. And the problem that Vitra had is that they had just built this huge showroom for their home. Vitra is a manufacturer of furniture. They started out making Charles Eames and George Nelson, and they've continued for the last 60, 70 years to do great design work. On their campus, they had just built this new showroom by Herzog and Dumeron for their home collection. Meanwhile, their office collection, which is really the bulk of their business, had no showroom. So it was sort of spread out along the campus. Like, there was a basement over here. There was like a second floor showroom over there. There was no like aggregated place where a person interested in buying Vitra's office furniture could come and see that. So we were given this box to do that in. And what we decided to do was we divided into two sections. One, which is a kind of categorical presentation of objects and products, and the other one, which is a more real life, sort of free form installation, something like you might actually find in a real office. When we inherited this space, it was totally subdivided by all kinds of partitions and IT offices. The first thing we did was strip out the space into one large, empty, sort of kind of factory floor. Then here you start to see the windows. We created a long display system where you could sort of sit. We had plugs for your laptop. So the idea, one of the ideas with the showroom was it should not be a showroom that you go and you look at stuff in. It should actually be a place where you can go and you can spend time. So everything in the space is outfitted with like electrical outlets, Wi-Fi. The idea is it's actually a place where people can use it as a real space. So this long bar kind of culminates with a coffee bar, and there's space in between these chairs where you can sort of post up with a laptop, you can freely pull a chair off the display, sit on it, put one up onto display. Another important element was this planning detail. We thought people are going to come to the showroom and they're trying to visualize their own office space. So how can we help them visualize space? And there was a great reference from the Eames office in Venice where they had a 20-foot tall ruler with 1 foot increments marked up and down the, so going vertically, and then they had another one that ran across the space in 1 foot increments. So as they were configuring their office, they had a full scale ruler in the space that allowed them to do that. So we thought, why not take this same principle, and you can sort of see these X marks on the floor. That represents a 2-meter by 2-meter grid, and it's spread across the entire showroom. So if you're there planning an office space, you can say, well, our space is 16 meters by 24 meters, and you can sort of immediately visualize that space on the floor while you're standing in it. This is the coffee bar, which ends that long bar. And you have like amazing views of the design museum from here as well. This is a categorical presentation of furniture. We basically had this enormous skylight that we had to restore because it's made out of fiberglass and had yellowed over the years. So we got to restore the fiberglass ceiling and bring down these partitions that in turn separate different office systems from one another. And they also bring the light into the space, like they catch a lot of the light. Categorical, kind of taxonomical displays of components. This was fun. This is a 40 meter long revolving billboard. It's the kind you might see like on a highway driving by. Normally they're used for like advertisements. What we did was we had this kind of idea that you shouldn't style the space to look like a real office, but instead you should go out into the real world where Vitra has furnished some of the greatest offices in Europe and all over the world. And so we hired an architectural photographer to go out and document three of the best offices that Vitra has furnished. So it was Vitra Design Museum's offices on their own campus, G-Star headquarters, and a space called Citizen Office. And so when you walk into the showroom, you walk in from this side, and you're looking at all of those office systems. Well, behind that, you have this backdrop of real life, real full-scale offices. And then every few minutes, you hear like the kind of like that nice sound as the whole billboard changes, mm-hmm. and then you look up and you have this entirely different space or backdrop behind you. This is fun. This is a view onto the actual factory. So this building on the, we're on the second floor. On the first floor of this building is a real functioning factory where they produce the Eames Aluminum Group chairs that you see here in the foreground. So you walk up this space, you're drawn towards the window, you get up to the window, and the only intervention we did on the space was adding this labeling that tells you what operations are happening on the floor, and adding this LED, this scrolling LED sign. What we did was we went down there and we interviewed one of the kind of manager of the factory about what happens and what are the processes here, and we transcribed that into English. And then, we transcribed it into German, and then we translated it into English. But then something, there's a really funny order here. We wrote the text in English, right? So we worked with this guy, we interviewed him, we wrote the text in English, because it also had a whole bunch of historical references. Then the Vitra's team translated it back into German. And then, by accident, somebody on the Vitra team translated it back into English. And so when I got to the factory, I was reading, I mean, this here you see the German scrolling, but when you got to the English scroll, it sounded like a English as a second language German speaker speaking at you. And then I said, and at first they were so embarrassed that this had happened. And I said, no, absolutely, we can't change it. We have to keep this because it sounds like, Jürgen on the factory floor telling you all about these processes. It was so perfect. So it was one of these like little humorous accidents that happens in work. So the showroom also had to function. This is one of the last pieces in that showroom. We thought, outside of being like a sales space, right? What do you want to do for your clients? What do you want to do for your salespeople? Well, really, you hope, the best you can hope for as a furniture manufacturer is to elevate the level of conversation that people have around the pieces that you're selling. So we thought, well, how do we do that? How do we get people to sort of up their knowledge, up the level of sophistication and the kinds of conversations they can have around these products? And so what we did was we spent, in tandem to this whole showroom project, my office kicked off this side project, which is called an office perspective. And it's basically the history of the office from 1850 to now. And each of those glass panels represents a different decade. And we basically look at the history of technology and the invention of things like air conditioning and elevators and escalators that actually make modern offices even possible. New work tools like the first ballpoint pen, the first typewriter. And we look at all of those changes in technology and office culture. And we even show films that covered the office and funny newspaper articles about the office. So it's a full sort of cultural, technological evolution of the workplace. And we ended up turning this into a public, like an actual newspaper that we published that you can take with you out of the showroom. Little detail was that when we first worked on this showroom project, we said, wouldn't it be nice to use technology? We could have hack some Kindles or iPads. And they said, absolutely not. We really can't have any technology in the space. Like, we don't want to be in there fixing the bugs that are going to happen in 6 months. So what we did, a few tricks, were we had this idea to do low-tech, high-tech in a way. So these glass panels, just by the fact that they're backlit with natural light, when you're in the space, they actually look like screens. So it feels very contemporary. It's like a mosaic almost. And then the earlier project that showed you this revolving billboard, like that thing it'll go for like 2 million cycles before it breaks, but it still introduces that level of like dynamism and excitement that you might get from LED screens or whatever. So the next project, back to manufacturing, a few years ago, the furniture industry, it tries to emulate the automotive industry. So that cars, think about the way a car is made, they make 20,000 of the exact same thing, standardize the production, churn them out of the plant as fast as they possibly can, and 20,000 people get the exact same thing, more or less. The architecture industry, as you probably know, is entirely different, especially today. There are buildings now, there are factories now that are capable of making 20,000 or 100,000 unique components that assemble into these really complex, larger buildings that you see. This factory here is called Zahner, and in Kansas City, Missouri. And they are really have been at the forefront of that whole manufacturing evolution. And they started in the early 80s working with Frank Gehry on the Seattle Music Project. And basically, through those kinds of buildings, they discovered that you know, these enormously complex shapes, they need thousands of, you know, if not millions of unique parts. And so they developed the software to be able to do that. So I wrote an article about this for Domus a few, like maybe 3 or 4 years ago, which dealt with the idea that somehow the furniture industry is really, at this point, decades behind in terms of its manufacturing technologies as one compared with the architecture production industry. So Bill Zahner, the owner of this company, read the article and said, why don't you come down and let's talk. And so I went down there and we started to look and talk about what kind of technologies they have that could be applied to furniture. For me, the most interesting part was these extrusions that you see in this bucket. They also happen to be the cheapest part on the factory floor. And these are the extrusions that you see that make up this scaffolding, which eventually gets clad with metal. So I thought there's a lot of potential in these extrusions because they can be bent in any shape you could imagine. So our first prototype, and this is actually nice, it's working in furniture at this scale, like the big chunk of building you see on the left is actually a part of the Peterson Automotive Museum. The I-beam on the right is just used to move parts around the factory. And to make a piece of furniture that's like almost at that scale in terms of length was the first time I'd ever worked on anything like that. So we decided to make a bench. Basically, I thought like, all right, if their technology is used in great dimensions vertically, furniture doesn't exist in the vertical dimension. At best, it exists in the horizontal dimension. So what happens when you knock that building down and you go horizontal, and then you can make a 100-foot bench or a 300-foot bench or a 20-foot bench? So this was the first prototype we made using those extrusions. And you can see the build is pretty simple. Basically, the extrusions you saw in the trash can represent the primary structural members. We did some cast aluminum legs that get bolted to the underside. And then these plates you see on top are actually the same plates that are joining the left and right extrusion. So it's a really simple build. There's only three components in the whole assembly. Actually four if you include this end cap, which is a cast aluminum end cap. The really most innovative thing about this product is that Zahner, everything they do is digitally driven. So they immediately said, well, why would we make one bench shape? Let's make infinite bench shapes. And let's develop a web platform that allows architects and designers to make any bench shape, any length they would want. So this this shop floor platform allows you to pick from some, you know, kind of existing alphabet of shapes, but it also allows you, using these push points, to customize the shape entirely. And you get a price in real time. This is an old price. We've actually been able to cut 30% of the cost out of this. So, yeah, and then you have a few features like you can lock, snap it to the grid, you can see dimensions. And so with this project, we've been able to do a number of installations. This was a project in Chicago where we exhibited the bench and a series of drawings by the artist Nathan Antelik that look at possible bench shapes based on the parameters of how you can form these things. And then now it's been about almost 2 years since we introduced this project, and so now we're starting to really see the thing go out into the world. So this was last week, I was in Stockholm installing this. It was a public park commissioned by Felix Burichter, the editor of Pinup magazine, and basically they subdivided this park into a number of areas, asked 10 designers to each do what they called a super bench. So when I went to visit the site, I found these boom courts, but they were really haphazardly made. They were kind of laid out with some rough wood mortars. So I said, let's recast these in concrete and let's place a bench at the entrance here. And more or less, like the bench, what's interesting for me about the bench is that it comes from architectural production, but it always requires an architectural setting to have its shape determined. So like if you look at, you know, this installation in Chicago, the bench really deals with that specific site, and we came up with a shape that sort of flirts with the existing architecture. Here, the bench is really oriented towards these bull courts and allowing a group of like, you know, 10 people to sit down in Stockholm in the summertime. They'll oftentimes bring like a bottle of wine out to the park and drink it while they're playing bull. So this was the inaugural bull game with some random cats at the park. So now after the first Vitro project I showed you, that was, for Vitro it was really successful. It's allowed them to talk about their products in a way that they couldn't ever do before. Last year in October, every 2 years they do a fair in Cologne called Orgatech. It's the largest event about office furniture globally. And every year Vitro does an enormous stand. They had sort of become fed up with their existing stand structure, which was in a hall with lots of other competitors. They complained to the fairgrounds, and the fair basically came back and said, well, you're our most important customer. What if we give you your own hall? Which is a tall order. So when we started working with Vitro on this project, we were given a hall which is roughly the size of this entire piece of paper here. Way too big, like way too much space. Vitro represents these black buildings. So we really needed to figure out, if we're gonna take up our own hall, how are we gonna fill the rest of the space? And then the idea came, well, what if we invited all these interesting companies that Vitro works with that don't typically exhibit in an office fair? So all of a sudden you can say like, well, let's have the bathroom company, and let's have the lighting company, and let's have the kitchen, the company that makes kitchens, and the company that makes flooring, and the company that does wooden floors versus carpeting, and bring all of those companies into one hall to really talk about the future of the office and how we're building offices today. And that's a very different idea than how a typical fair works. Typical fair, you'll have 10 producers of office chairs all right next to each other, all fighting it out, trying to win the customer's attention. And it's a really competitive environment and not really a place where you want to spend time. So we thought, what if we create this hall? Pranilla, the architect I worked with, she came out to LA. We were out in Pioneer Town, which is in Joshua Tree, if you've ever been there. It's basically a mock or kind of fake Wild Western town. And you have a main street and you have these small buildings on either side, and the uniting element is the horizon. So we thought, okay, what if we have this enormous space, what if we do this sort of main street like you have in an old Western town? We put all the competitors on, or all the partner companies on one side, Vitro on the other. They're sort of like the church and state, and then you have like your shoemaker, your bank, your tobacco shop, and let's surround them by a huge horizon like you have in these Wild Western towns. Not to say that we're trying to replicate the Wild West, more just to say that we're trying to create a village of like-minded companies, and at the same time refer to this idea of like the passage of time. Work happens from morning to night. If today it happens across time zones. Oftentimes, like I'm doing 6 a.m. Skype calls with Europe, and it's and for them that's like 5 p.m. So 4 p.m. We worked with a graphic designer, Wilm Tobin, who's at UCLA, and basically developed a gradient that goes from sunrise at the entrance all the way to sunset at the end. So you could imagine this was Los Angeles and this was London. So this was the entrance hall at sunrise. Here you have like the corridor, you see like high noon, it's very blue. Here you have some of the stands or partner companies behind where you have the horizon uniting them all. And then on the main street, we put these little kiosks, like almost like the little shoemaker or whatever, and we invited different technology companies to exhibit what they could do. So we had like Autodesk, and we had Samsung, and kind of displaying like new work technology. This next project is sort of the last project I'll show you, but it's a larger, it represents a new way of working for me. All the other projects you've seen here were, with the exception of source material, they were all client driven. They were all, a company has asked me to work on something, we work on it together, we develop it. This project is entirely different. It's more of an ongoing series of artistic interests that have resulted in products and installations, but it's not the kind of typical model of sort of design for hire. So about a year and a half ago, I teach sometimes at the Graduate School of Design at Harvard. They bought this house, which is a Philip Johnson thesis house. And they're using it. It was this house that Johnson built for himself as his thesis project while he was a student at the school. They're using the house as a residency for artists. But when they bought it, it had no furniture whatsoever. So I was sort of in dialogue with the dean about saying, well, what if we could, maybe we should contribute some new furniture. Maybe this building justifies creating some new pieces of furniture. And so when I looked at the original floor plans, I saw that the biggest piece of furniture in the house was this Mies van der Rohe daybed. You never get a chance to do a daybed. Most furniture producers nowadays, like they sell very few of these typologies. Most people don't buy them. So it's a really special type of furniture. And so I thought, all right, let's do it. Let's do a daybed, let's do one for the space. The interesting part about the space is that the columns of the space are made by a wooden mast maker. This is like 1940s in Boston, it's wartime, there's like restrictions on what you can buy in terms of metal. So Johnson goes and works with a New England mast maker. At the time, they made their masts out of wood. So I thought, well, if we're gonna do a daybed, we should definitely work with a New England mast maker. The only difference is that today, the New England mast makers work in carbon fiber. They don't work in wood. So we worked with a company called Hall Composites in Bristol, Rhode Island, and they build like masts for America's Cup racing boats. They also do a number of parts for like SpaceX. And this, what you see here on the bottom here, this is like the structural carbon fiber. And this then, you'll sort of see in this project, there's a number of triggers, right? So the Johnson House triggers the idea of doing a daybed. The columns in the house trigger the idea of working in carbon fibers. The carbon fiber ends up triggering a need for a new product, which is a textile that can work with carbon fiber and be offer like a cushion or soft component that you can mix with carbon fiber. And what happened was that we had this great carbon fiber producer that could make us the structural parts for a daybed, and that includes flexible parts, rigid parts. But then you say, okay, well, I need a cushion or a pillow for this thing. And you start looking at the world of existing textiles, and you don't find anything that works, mostly because carbon fiber is already a textile. So it's a twill weave textile, so you can look at your jeans, that's a twill weave. It basically means over, under, and that pattern gets repeated ad infinitum. So you end up with this diagonal striping. So what we did was, I've had a relationship with a Danish textile manufacturer named Quadra for a number of years. And I contacted them and I said, listen, I think we have a good reason to do a new textile that's basically a copy of carbon fiber, or you could say like a sister textile or sibling textile to carbon fiber. So what we did was we took the same weave, which is a twill weave, we dyed the colors to more or less match the colors of carbon fiber, and we've developed this twin textile or sibling textile. So now, the beauty about that is that all of a sudden, for the first time, by accident, you can make a piece of furniture that's entirely made out of textile, which is a huge breakthrough in terms of how things are manufactured. Like it used to be, if you look at any of the history of modern furniture, it's always steel and leather, or it's fiberglass and leather, or fiberglass and cloth. Now we can have the entire piece of furniture made out of one weave pattern, which is a twill weave piece of furniture. So then what that means is you go from really soft and cushy to really thin and flexible. This is the full daybed. So you have, so in the same object, you have this really soft cushion. You have these really stiff, rigid members that are stronger than steel. Same goes for the legs. And then in between, you have this really thin 4 or 5 ply piece of carbon fiber that's like 2 millimeters thick. And you can see how much it's bending under his weight. So you have really flexible and bouncy parts, you have really rigid parts, and you have soft and cushy parts, all made out of textile. So this then triggered Quadrat to say, and this project is ongoing, so this, what I'm showing you now is like research that I'm actively doing right now. This triggered Quadrat to say, hey, this textile could be really successful for us, now let's turn it into a commercial textile, let's make 20 or 30 colors. So that then sent me into a bit of like a panic mode, because if you look at any of the furniture I've shown you so far, it's all white or black. So color for me has been it's never been something that I was like immediately drawn to, but the fact that carbon comes from the Earth's crust all of a sudden provided like an opportunity where I was like, okay, I didn't choose the color of the first textile, right? This gray color chose itself because carbon is carbon, it's graphite, it comes from the Earth's crust. So where can I look at other colors that come directly from the Earth's crust? And so it happens that Harvard, their art museum, has a center called the Strauss Center for Technical Studies and Conservation. At that center, they have an extensive collection of minerals and that have been used as artist pigments. So these are all the stones you see here. You have like lapis lazuli, red matter on an alumina base. This is Armenian bowl. This is like green earth, malachite, orpiment. Over here, I think this is, where is it? This is indigo. Right, so you have all these like amazing, amazing colors. Realgar up here, you have a red realgar and an orange realgar. So all of these colors are like, they're amazing, amazing colors. I think what I realized was what was problematic for me in the past choosing colors is that you get this sample book, like a Pantone book or like an RAL book. And these are industrialized colors. And you just feel like, all right, like time to pick some colors. Like what's the logic? What's the rationale? Here, the rationale was, let's look at real earth-based colors. And let's extract color from that. So from here, basically, we photographed these colors. We extracted single colors from them, and then going back to like the warp and weft, we take the high value from each stone, and that's the light color, which is the warp, and we take the darkest value from each stone, and that gives us the weft. And so now we're in the process. I don't know if photos of this yet, but this summer the dye maker or the dyer for the textiles is producing the first run of textiles that are coming out of these colors. So somehow the house, the Philip Johnson thesis house, triggered investigation into carbon fiber because of the wooden masts. The carbon fiber triggered a research project into textile design and making a sister textile. The textile then further triggered the research into color and what other colors come from the Earth's crust. The last stage of this project was realized last October, where we were asked, myself and the architects, LA architects Johnson Markley, were asked to do an installation for the Kortrijk Furniture Fair in Brussels, in Belgium, outside of Brussels. And they said, it was curated by Kirsten Geers and David Van Severen of Office. And they gave 10 different designers, artists, one of these sort of corrugated steel boxes. And said, you can do whatever you want inside, but it should revolve around an interior. Now, in the past, I've worked with architects, and usually the furniture designer is responding to a building, like you saw with the relationship of the Johnson House and the Daybed. In this case, there was no building, and we had like 3 months to do something. So there was no chance for me to, for first Johnson Markley to make a space, and then me to react to the space with a piece of furniture. So we said, well, why don't we flip this equation? And rather than me respond to the architecture, let's have Johnson Markley respond to a single piece of furniture. So we called this installation Room for a Daybed. And so the piece of furniture, as you know, it's made entirely from cloth and textile. We got Quadrat to donate a large amount of textile so that we could make this entire space that's also made of textile. Even the lamp, which you see up above, is made entirely of cloth, and it's used on Hollywood production sets to light, to basically bring daylight into artificially lit environments. So, the floor was felt, the walls are felt, the ceiling, the light is also textile. And it was a nice, pretty successful installation in the sense that people really like moved in and out of the space. You know, the surrounding environment was very noisy. It's like a busy fairground. And so this room for a day bed was so dampened by all the cloth and the felt that it became a really quiet space. At the same time, we took that daylight and we turned it down as far as possible. So you had natural light, but it wasn't too bright. So this project, I think this is one of my favorite projects because it's not, you can't define it as product design. It's definitely not an architecture project. It's also not a textile design project. It's not an installation, but yet it's all of these things all at the same time. And that kind of hybrid ground is something that I think it's really possible today in terms of where industry is going. And it's really exciting as a designer to work at those intersections of different types of activities. So that's all. I figured we'd take the short way out and leave some time for presentations before people start falling asleep.
Okay, we have time for a few questions. Does anybody have a question? Thank you.
hi. So about the textile and the cost of the final project you showed.
Yes.
Okay. Can you please explain, like give some explanation about like since this is an ongoing project, what's the progress so far?
So we've done a daybed. We made six, there was a minimum order. We're really doing one daybed for the Philip Johnson thesis house, but the manufacturer had a minimum order of six. So we made six. Those exist today. I have one, Quadrat has one, the thesis house has one, and the other three have gone to like design museum collections, like Beecher Design Museum, Art Institute of Chicago. So that's part of the project is more or less finished. We could always make more daybeds, but it's not exactly, like I mentioned, it's not a super commercial typology, and the process we're using here is very expensive, so it's a really expensive daybed. The textile, though, which you see on the cushion, that's a real product. So that will be introduced at the last part of this year, like in November, and at that point you'll be able to buy that textile in probably like up to 20 colors. And you'll be able to use, it's a wool textile, so it's meant for furniture. We're also developing a synthetic textile in the same pattern and same color series. So you'll be able to use that textile on like anything from pillows to sofas to interiors. So the textile lives on as a kind of mass-produced product. We're gonna do another exhibition also in the fall and next year that where we take the pigments from we'll be able to take these pigments from the museum and show them next to the textiles we developed. So that'll be a traveling exhibition. The room for a daybed was a one-time installation. So in a way, the thing that really lives on from all of this is six daybeds and a textile that you can buy in any color, hopefully for a long time.
Any other questions?
Thanks for coming. This may just be the way that you present your work, but it's very your design process seems journalistic in a sense. So you use the term triggered, which is kind of interesting. Could you just talk a little bit maybe on how your design process has evolved and maybe the major influences?
You're a really quick study. Journalistic, I've used that word to describe my design process in the past. I'm sure it's been used to describe other people's design processes, but I've never come across it. I think it has to do with the fact that I actually, when I first started my practice in 2006, I had like one client, and you have to kind of earn a living at that stage. And so I remember I had read a lot of Donald Judd's writings and a lot of George Nelson's writings, and understood that like Donald Judd wrote in his early years, he wrote as a kind of mercenary critic for Art Forum or Art Review. George Nelson did extensive writing throughout his whole career. And so I started really early on thinking like, okay, writing will be a part of what I do. Because I actually had a background in writing. I went to Boston College and the New School before I studied industrial design. So I have that ability. And what it's done is it's allowed me to I use it to like sniff things out. You know, like I use it as a, like you can see the Zahner bench was really a result of an article that I wrote. You could even say that the aluminum chair was a result of an article I wrote for Domus about the US furniture industry. And through that article, I actually met the design director of Knoll and all the other companies. And sort of that's how that relationship even started. So I approach each new project almost like an article in a sense. Like I just start researching the material and getting it out there and like pulling it and sort of following my nose around, and that's in a way how I ended up at this pigment collection was because I was like chasing this idea of like how am I going to resolve colors, and all of a sudden like I remember being in Stockholm like in November for a site visit for those bull courts and looking at all the colors in the buildings and being like these colors they feel right, like, and I was with Pernilla, the architect I work with, and she was like, well, you know, these paints, the Stockholm's, the paints on these buildings come from local minerals, And I was like, oh, mineral, there you go. So then I had a friend who used to be the director of the Harvard Art Museum. I called him up, because I remember him telling me about this trip he went on collecting artist pigments in Australia with Narayan, who's the curator or the director of the Strauss Center for Conservation and Technical Studies. So then he put me in touch with him. Then I went to the place, saw the stone. Then it was a while between I figured out, like, okay, there's millions of artist pigments. Many of them are even artificial. Oh, but then there's this certain group that come from minerals and from the Earth's crust. Let's isolate those. So it is, it's totally journalistic. And I think, I don't show like sketches. I mean, I think there's one, maybe like the only pictures of models here were like these ones. You know, these models I show because that was an important three-dimensional research process. And I don't even have a model for the aluminum bench because the first one you saw was the first one we made. These would be the equivalent of photographs of models. And I took these with a camera while I was doing a factory visit. So it is very much about like investigating the subject. My process, I basically go from like research to finished thing. There isn't like a wide array of formal varieties and things like that. Like even this bench, like look, this bench, the shapes, like they're barely determined by me. Like that, I didn't design that part. The curves are based on minimum and maximum bend radiuses. There's no maximum. So the only thing I did was the legs, which are really, really simple. Same deal with the daybed. These are all existing mandrels from sailboats. So like that leg is actually like a mast, and that tube is used for something else on the, I mean, I literally went into the factory and like they're pulling molds off the shelf and saying, okay, how can we reconfigure, because we didn't want to pay for the production of new molds. So we just used, so this is very much like, it, you know, you're just pulling stuff out. But I don't know, does that kind of, okay, yeah.
Any other questions? I have a question for you. I mean, you mentioned Mies and, when you mentioned you first saw your office chair in the company of others. My question would be, like, from the history of furniture design, is there anything, do you have a certain affinity? Is there anything that you feel like has influenced you?
Yeah, I think like the best historians I know are all designers and architects. I mean, of course there's really great design curators and design historians, but literally like the people I know who know the most depth about the history of their field are some of the best practitioners. I mean, we talked about Johnson Markley, like Markley is like an encyclopedia. Konstantin Gerchich, who's a designer I worked with when I was just out of college, he's another encyclopedia. I think like having an encyclopedic knowledge of everything that's come before, like it takes time, it takes curiosity, it takes passion. And then you kind of forget about it, at least I feel. Like the first years, I feel like I was really like, if you look at my very, very first project, I probably would have like, at that time, I probably would have talked about it exclusively in terms of references and other designers' work that I was looking at. Like there's details here that echo things that Enzo Mari did for Danese. There's a whole lot of historical looking in this project, but now I don't even use those terms, and I think now I kind of, or at least, I mean, I still look at references, but the references are more obscure. Like right now I'm looking at like Porsche SC and Carrara builds in terms of how the components are assembled. And so I've been going to all these like events and taking photos and buying books on automotive clay modeling and because I'm interested in that process, you know, and I think that will translate. I think it's not yet, or not anymore, that I'm really like looking specifically at Mies and saying, oh, that piece of furniture is great. Like, how can I do something like it? Or you know all of that stuff like intimately, and like my house is probably like a small design museum. You know, like you kind of end up acquiring that stuff and surrounding yourself with all those references, and they play an important role.
Great. Thank you so much, Jonathan. just a quick announcement. We have two more lectures in the spring. Next week will be Ed Augusta, architect, and then the week after, Lorna Herling.